What's going on, Bottom Line viewers? It's Mitch here of The Bottom Line View, back with another episode of the NFL Top 100 Players of 2017. Again, this is my opinion on who are the top 100 players in the NFL heading into the 2017 NFL season. This list was made using my knowledge of last year's play, stats, and advanced stats while also looking ahead into next season and judging who really are the best players when they step foot on the field week one of the 2017 NFL season. Let me know in the comments what your thoughts are on my top 100 list. This is the second to last episode, numbers 20 to 11. I hope you enjoy. Starting with number 20, we have Drew Brees, quarterback number 4 of the New Orleans Saints. Now, Drew Brees is arguably the most underrated quarterback in NFL history. This guy has had more 5,000-yard seasons than anyone. He'll probably end up breaking the yards and touchdown records when his career ends. Despite never winning an MVP, he's always been amongst the leaders in both categories in touchdowns and yards. He's one of the most cerebral quarterbacks in the history of the game. He's so smart. He's very accurate in short and deep passes. And Drew Brees is a great leader on and off the field. Drew Brees is everything you want from a quarterback. Again, last year, he threw for over 5,000 yards, leading the league with 5,200, had 37 touchdowns, had 15 interceptions, and an 101.7 passer rating. That's pretty much around the average for Drew Brees nowadays. You can expect around 40 touchdowns. You can expect around 5,000 yards. Drew Brees, year in and year out, is going to do that for you. He's also going to be a great fantasy asset for you. Drew Brees is just, what else do you have to say? The guy has great mobility for his size, only being at around 6 feet. That was his disadvantage, and still is considered his disadvantage, is his height and his size. But he uses his size to his best ability to avoid defenders, to throw the ball in a high arcing motion, and he's very, very, very accurate. He's probably in the top three, if not the most accurate quarterback in the NFL in whatever pass you want to throw. So Drew Brees, still one of the best quarterbacks in the NFL. Can't really say much more that hasn't already been said about Mr. Drew Brees, a future Hall of Famer, a Super Bowl champion. The only thing he really needs to add to his resume is an MVP trophy, which for some reason he has never won. He does have maybe an ability to do that next season with a team that is on the rise in New Orleans. So expect Drew Brees to have another very good year in 2017, ranking here at number 20. At number 19, I have Eric Berry, safety number 2 on the top 100 players of 2017. In 2016, he had 77 tackles, 1 forced fumble, 9 pass deflections, 4 interceptions, and 2 touchdowns. Pretty much filling the stat sheet for whatever a safety can do. Eric Berry was one of the most exciting players on the defensive side of the ball to watch last season. Not only has he had to overcome a lot in his off-the-field life, in his personal life, he's had to overcome a lot. But on the field, he's gotten even better despite all of these things that has happened to him. All the setbacks, Eric Berry has only taken a step forward in his game as one of the premier safeties in the NFL. Again, provided 77 tackles, had that forced fumble, had 2 touchdowns, including 1 2-point conversion that won himself the game against the NFC champion Atlanta Falcons, had 4 interceptions, made tons of plays for the Kansas City Chiefs, and that's really what the Chiefs are all about. Eric Berry is the leader of that defense, and he really stands for what the Chiefs do on defense, and that's turn the football over, that's make plays, and that's set up their offense in the best situation possible. Eric Berry certainly did that last season. He's an all-around great safety, capable of basically anything. He's upped his game in coverage. He's still a great tackler in the box, and he can do it all. He can play free safety. He can play strong safety. Eric Berry is the man, coming in at number 19. At number 18, I have, in my opinion, the best corner in the entire NFL, and that's Aqib Talib of the Denver Broncos. He had 43 tackles, 12 pass deflections, 3 interceptions, and 1 pick 6 last year. Aqib Talib proved week in and week out, no matter who he played against, the best receivers in the NFL, he can take them out of the game. We saw Aqib Talib a few seasons ago really break out as a shutdown corner as a member of the New England Patriots. And then ever since he signed with the Denver Broncos, he's become elite and more elite every season that he's worn that Broncos helmet. He won a Super Bowl with them the year previous, and this year he had an even better year than winning the Super Bowl. He was a Pro Bowl corner, a first team All-Pro, had three interceptions, one touchdown. Like I said, it didn't matter who he played against, Aqib Talib. He would take him out of the game. He would get in your face. It doesn't matter if you rip his chain off. He's going to punch you in the face. He's going to get at it. And that's something I really, really like about Aqib Talib's game. He's really aggressive. He gets in the receiver's face. He'll talk trash. He'll intimidate you. And he'll beat you. And that's what I love about Aqib Talib. He talks the talk and he walks the walk. At number 17, I have Luke Keuchly, in my opinion, still the best middle linebacker in the NFL. Luke Keuchly had 102 tackles, 2 sacks, 1 forced fumble, and 1 interception in 2017. Now, Bobby Wagner probably had the better season than Luke Keuchly last year, but Luke Keuchly only got to play really half the games last year, but still with only half the games was providing a great stat line and great play for the Carolina Panthers. Now, the Panthers' defense took a step back, especially when Luke Keuchly was off the field. When Luke Keuchly was off the field, we saw all the flaws of the Carolina Panthers come to head, and really, Luke Keuchly is that leader. Luke Keuchly is the best player on the Carolina Panthers. No matter what Cam Newton has done, no matter how many MVP trophies he has won, Luke Keuchly is a future Hall of Famer. Luke Keuchly is an elite linebacker, and not many middle linebackers are like Luke Keuchly ever in the history of the game. He is the best in pursuit against the run. He's one of the best in zone coverage, especially the ability to read the quarterback, the ability to sit back and take a pick to the house. We've seen it so many years in a row now. We've seen it so many games in a row where Luke Keuchly can make a play that not many middle linebackers can make. There's one thing where you're a linebacker, especially specifically a middle linebacker, and this is what I think separates a lot of middle linebackers. There's middle linebackers like Luke Keuchly who make the tackles. They get occasionally a couple sacks. They can blitz. They can do it all. They can cover. They can cover the tight end. They can cover a running back. They can make a pick and bring it back to the house. And that is an elite Luke Keuchly-like linebacker. But then there are also linebackers that get a lot of recognition as well. And those are just the ones that, you know, make a lot of tackles. They may lead the league in tackles occasionally, but they don't do much else. And what I'm trying to say is Luke Keuchly is that guy that does everything else. He can give you those sacks. He can get you that pass rush. He can force a fumble. He can take a pick to the house. He can tackle. It doesn't matter what you ask of Luke Keuchly at the middle linebacker position. He can put your defense in charge and he can do it all. And that's what you have to appreciate about Luke Keuchly, this one in a generation talent at middle linebacker. At number 16, I have Landon Collins, in my opinion, the best safety in the NFL, specifically last season, having 125 tackles, 4 sacks, 13 pass deflections, 5 interceptions, and 1 touchdown. Now, if you never like seen it, look at that stat sheet, okay? That stat sheet is probably the most filled of any defensive player I have seen this past season. 125 tackles. That's good for one of the best in the league. 4 sacks for a safety. That's probably first. I'm not exactly sure, but that's at least in the top 3. 13 pass deflections. That's phenomenal. 5 picks. That's amongst the top 5 in the league. A touchdown. That's superb. I mean, Landon Collins, I had him ranked as one of the most underrated players in the NFL on my top 10 list. I really think this guy is a top 20 player in the league. We saw it last year. He was up for Defensive Player of the Year. We saw how good the Giants defense played last year and specifically how good their secondary was. And their secondary was that good because they had the ability to move Landon Collins and do all these sort of things. Landon Collins can play linebacker. Landon Collins can play slot corner. Landon Collins can play strong or free safety. He can tackle a guy in the box. We've seen multiple plays on tape where this guy comes and he runs down the running back. This guy can cover the tight end. I mean, Landon Collins can do it all. He's an intimidating force. He hits hard. He makes plays. And this is a giant defender if I've ever seen one, coming in at number 16. Number 15, in my opinion, the best offensive lineman in the NFL, that's Marshal Yanda. The NFL and Pro Football Focus also agrees with me, ranking Marshal Yanda as the best offensive lineman in the NFL. Now, Yanda didn't get a ton of recognition like many Cowboys or Raiders or any of those offensive lines did last year. But Yanda has been a successful and constant force of the offensive line of the Baltimore Ravens for years now. In my opinion, he's still the best guard and the best offensive lineman in the league. He's just so consistent, so solid. He never gets beat. He's phenomenal in the run game. He's a great pulling guard. He's athletic. He's strong. He's great in pass protection. And really, there's nothing much else you could say about Yanda other than he's phenomenal, he's great, and he's consistent. And that's exactly what you want from an offensive lineman. Yanda ranks in as the number one offensive lineman in the NFL, coming in at number 15 overall. At number 14, I have one of the most exciting, arguably the most exciting player in the entire league. That's Odell Beckham. Now, Odell Beckham was very close for me for ranking in the top 10 because I think the way I did my list was I looked at the positions, and the position of wide receiver is amongst the strongest in the league. And Odell Beckham ranks in as the number three receiver. But honestly, all the top three receivers could flip depending on the day of the week for me. So Odell Beckham had 101 receptions last year, had 1,300 yards, 13.5 yards per catch, and 10 touchdowns. And a lot of those touchdowns weren't just touchdowns like, okay, 1 yard line fade. No, Odell Beckham will grab a ball from the 1 yard line, his 1 yard line, and run it all the way to the other end zone. This guy is arguably and probably the toughest tackle in the NFL when it comes to after the catch. We've seen in highlights, just go to YouTube, search after this video, search up Odell Beckham highlights, and you'll see an Odell Beckham slant pass where he takes it about 80 yards to the house. This guy is phenomenal after the catch, and that makes him so dangerous in a similar fashion to a Randy Moss. Odell Beckham is one of the most exciting players we've seen in a long time, arguably the most exciting player in the league. He's an all-around great receiver with arguably the best hands in the league, great route running ability, great after the catch ability, great toughness inside to catch inside passes against strong safeties and corners, not afraid to get hit. And oh yeah, he'll celebrate after the fact. So I love Odell Beckham's game all around. He's a great player. It takes probably multiple players on a play to at least slow him down. You're never really going to slow him down unless you get in his head. And that's one of the weaknesses we've seen of Odell. If you can get in his head, he's kind of slowed down in similar games, you know, in some games with Josh Norman specifically. But Odell, if you can get past that a little bit, get more focus on the field, get more focus on just his game individually, and not get down on himself. This guy could easily be the best receiver in the league, and maybe even the best receiver ever. Yeah, I said it. I'm a huge Moss fan. I'm a Rice fan. Rice is the GOAT. But Beckham has the abilities, has the pure skill set, and has the stats to back up his case if he continues on this path. We've never really seen a receiver this good in their first 3 to 4 seasons than really Randy Moss. And besides that, Odell Beckham is right in that category. So watch out for this guy. If he continues down this path, we could be ranking him in the top 5 at least of all time. I think Odell's well on his way to the Hall of Fame. And if he continues to play this way and continues to electrify fans, he'll be a legend in New York for years to come. At number 13, I have Ezekiel Elliott, the running back 3. On the top 100. Now, I probably could have flip-flopped Odell and Zeke. I think it's pretty close. But these two guys were equal threats for their teams. The only difference for me is that Elliott was actually looked upon as maybe an MVP candidate at certain portions of the season. At the end of the day, he didn't end up winning the MVP. But he was the biggest reason, in my opinion, for the Dallas Cowboys going from last in the NFC East to first and going to the number one seed in the NFC. Yes, they lost their first playoff game. But it wasn't really Zeke's problem. I mean, Zeke played a really tough run defense. He still had a couple of good plays here and there. And oh yeah, he had 1,600 yards, 5.1 yards per catch, 16 touchdowns, 32 catches, and 363 yards during the season. Nearly 2,000 yards, 16 touchdowns, 32 catches, over 5 yards per carry, which is probably the best in the league. I'm not exact on that, but that is amongst the best of the elite running backs in the league. Zeke Elliott, yes, he's playing behind the best offensive line in football. Yes, he has Zach Martin. Yes, he has Travis Frederick. Yes, he has all these guys, Tyron Smith. But Ezekiel Elliott's ability to break away in space is absolutely probably the best in the league for any running back. His second level burst is phenomenal. His ability to find the hole is extremely intelligent and special. And his ability to break tackles is second to none. So, I mean, Ezekiel Elliott, it has all the tools to become the best running back in the league. I don't think he's quite there. I have him ranked as running back 3. I think there are two guys ahead of him that have more of a well-rounded skill set that make their case to be the best running back in the league. But I do think that Elliott, maybe any other year of the season, could have been the best running back in the NFL. He led the league in rushing by about 200 yards. So, I mean, he could do this again next year, and we could be talking about the best running back in the league. It's just a matter of eating for Zeke, and we'll see if he eats more in 2017. I have him here at number 13. At number 12, I have, in my opinion, and I've done a video on this and a debate, and if you don't agree with me, check my video out and debate as well. It's Rob Gronkowski versus Tony Gonzalez, and I just spoiled who's number 12. It's Rob Gronkowski, the tight end number one in the NFL, and also, yes, in my opinion, the greatest tight end in NFL history. He had 25 receptions this past season, 540 yards, and 3 touchdowns. Now, on the surface, that doesn't seem very good. Well, when you think about it, the guy was basically averaging 100 yards a game because he only played like 3 games. He only played like 3, 4, 5, maybe 5 games in total. He was hurt in like 2 of those, and he had 540 yards, which was basically, if you average that out, he had about 100 yards per game. He was averaging about 4 receptions or 5 receptions a game. And get this, this would have been a record if it would have stood throughout the course of the season. 21.6 yards per catch for a freaking tight end, bro. Rob Gronkowski was going off this past season with 21.6 yards per catch. That would have been the highest yards per catch, not only for a receiver this season, not only for a tight end this season, but in NFL history for a tight end. That would have been absolutely phenomenal, and it would have smashed the record by like 3 yards. Rob Gronkowski was on a mission last year, even after being banged up. I can only imagine what the Super Bowl champions will be able to do with this guy in their lineup. Gronk, in my opinion, is the absolute greatest tight end in NFL history for his ability to catch the ball, for his ability to beat multiple defenders. Doesn't matter who he's against, a linebacker, a tight end, a corner, a safety. It does not matter. It doesn't matter if it's two guys. It doesn't matter if it's zone help. It doesn't matter if it's double coverage. It doesn't matter if it's two guys pressing and one over the top. It doesn't matter who it is. Rob Gronkowski is going to get ball from Tom Brady, and he's going to score touchdowns every single week, and you can't really help it. But also what he does is he allows other receivers to get open. He also blocks phenomenally, probably the best tight end in blocking in the game. He's an all-around phenomenal force, and he is the best tight end of all time. Coming in at number 12. Would be higher, but he didn't play enough games. At number 11, I have J.J. Watt, defensive lineman number 2, and this might shock some people to end this 20 to 11 list in the second-to-last part of the top 100. Now, J.J. Watt, if you didn't rank him already, why are you ranking him so high? Or why didn't you not just rank him on the list? Well, I felt like I should rank the injured players, but I should give them a little bit of, you know, a step back. Because they didn't... I don't want to quite say that Gronk and Watt are top 10 players because they didn't really play last year. Specifically, J.J. Watt. He only had 8 tackles and 1.5 sacks because he only played in, like, 2 games. Maybe 3. So it's tough for J.J. Watt to really say he's still the best defender in the league and he's still the best defensive lineman and he's still a top 10 player. It's very difficult for me to say that because he didn't play enough games last year. And really when he did play, I mean, he was still good, but he wasn't like J.J. Watt good. So it's tough. But I still think J.J. Watt is going to rebound. I think he's going to have a phenomenal year. I think he's maybe going to lead the league in sacks. He might even win Defensive Player of the Year again next year. But J.J. Watt is, like Rob Gronkowski, he might end up being the best at his position of all time. He's going to be a Hall of Famer. He's already won 3 Defensive Player of the Years. He's already led teams that shouldn't have went to the playoffs to the playoffs. He's already made defensive units that weren't really good. I mean, J.J. Watt is a game-changing player. He's a defensive-changing player, and he's a team-changing player. And that's something you don't often see from a team. You see Lawrence Taylor. I mean, you see Reggie White. Bruce Smith, maybe. I mean, there's some players in there that occasionally, Ray Lewis, change a defense. But J.J. Watt is in that conversation. He's in the conversation for the most dominant player in history. Offensive or defensive, J.J. Watt is that animal. And I think that even with the stats, even with the injuries this season, he still deserves to be in a good place on the top 100. I don't think he's quite top 10 right now because he didn't really prove himself last year. But look at his track record. Look at his sacks. Look at his numbers. Look at his awards. J.J. Watt is still a great player, and he comes in at number 11. Okay, guys, thank you for joining me on the Top 100, second to last episode. That was players number 20 to 11. Make sure you tune in to the last episode of my Top 100. I'll let you know some players that will be on the list. I won't let you know the order right now, but I'll let you know the players, and then you can try and guess your order so that when that video comes out, you can say, okay, this is the order. You can comment that before you even watch the video and let me know what your order was going to be for the top 10. But these are the top 10 players, in my personal opinion, in the NFL right now. David Johnson, Matt Ryan, Antonio Brown, Le'Veon Bell, Aaron Donald, Von Miller, Khalil Mack, Julio Jones, Tom Brady, and Aaron Rodgers. Who were your number one? Who is your number 10? Who is your number 9, 5, and so on? Let me know in this comment section, and also let me know in the comment section in the next video, which is going to be the top 10 players in the NFL in 2017. Let me know that, but I hope you guys enjoyed this players number 20 to 11. Let me know if you disagreed, if you agreed. What players do you think should be higher? What players do you think you should be lower? Do you agree with my placements of the injured players? And so on. Thanks, guys, for tuning in. Really appreciate it. It's Mitch of The Bottom Line View. Peace out.